Since he wore purple all the time, could we legally call him the Grapist?
That's why everyone going with the Mephisto theories, I was like,
constantly, that's just the that's entire life of his miniseries, still looking for a shirt.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of the Happy 616th Marvel Family. Today, we have a special guest for our cheat day, someone who's going to participate in our comic book adultery.
Woo!
I am your host, the Funny Hatter, and figuratively to my left is...
Poppet or Puppet, either or.
Yes, our guest, the Poppet Puppet.
Yes.
Is that, did I say it right?
Sure, yes.
Okay. Something like that.
Good enough. She will be talking to us about the kind of person that she wants to cheat with today, and Ooh. According to comics. And figuratively to my right is...
I am the A-Victor, the X-Man, once again returning.
Yes, back at it again.
And figuratively, right behind me, I just noticed right now.
Yes, I'm always right there, always right behind you, everywhere you go. And it's me, Christopher. Hello, always sneaking behind you. Just very friendly though, not in any sort of creepy way. You know, just very casually, just, you know, right behind you at all times.
You know, that would actually be a first time for me. I don't think I've ever had anybody who snuck up right behind me with friendly intentions.
Oh, well, all right. Well, yeah. I'm glad to be the first then.
First time,
oh yeah. What shampoo is that, by the way? It smells really nice, gotta say.
Here, hold on, I gotta get my charger. One second, as I stall for time by putting things into my computer that make it run faster, longer, better.
Ooh, that's selling more RAM.
Okay, so if you have been following our podcast for the longest time, then good for you. You know what's coming up. It's our 15th episode. If you haven't, well, every 5 episodes, we like to commit a little bit of comic book adultery. Considering that we are a Marvel podcast, we do like to talk things a bit off topic just to keep things interesting. So today, everybody is going to be selecting a character that is not associated or created by Marvel, just to mix things up a bit. And so, to get things started, we are going to the Wheel of Fortune to find out who is my favorite person of the day. And my favorite person of the day will get to be the person who gets to talk first.
Oh, yeah.
And as we spin the wheel, we find out that my favorite person of the day is going to be... Christopher!
Oh, no.
Hey!
I mean, yay!
Insert clap here. So please, without further ado, tell us... Who is on your mind today that is not Marvel?
Oh, yes, I've been thinking about who to cheat on for a while now. I've been banging my head against the wall, really trying to figure it out, really trying to get the old brain juices flowing. And I gotta say...
Billy Batson!
Yeah, Billy Batson! I gotta say, it's gonna be a very big surprise, but today, we're talking about, Batman! No, seriously, today, I'm not sure, you know, this isn't exactly a superhero character, but it is a character from a graphic novel. I wanted to talk about Scott Pilgrim himself today.
Ooh, that's
yes.
A first.
Yes.
That he talked about Batman twice in a row.
I know,
last
right?
Time.
I was thinking, oh, there's so many other Batman stuff I could talk about to take up more people's time with Batman. But I figured today we'd break it up with Scott Pilgrim. But hopefully Michael Cera will be playing Batman in the future. You never know. It's a possibility.
Yeah. I would be interested in Michael Cera Batman.
Yeah, let's get it done. It's gonna be great. Scott Pilgrim. So I've got to admit, I haven't actually read all of the graphic novels. I'm familiar with how it ends. I know it ends differently than the movie, but I've watched Scott Pilgrim for so many years. My friend got really, really into it, and I was like, all right, I gotta see this movie, and I watched it, and I was like, this is so good, and I watched it like at least twice a year, if not more. It's just so much fun. And then I bought the two of the graphic novels, the first two. And then, right as COVID, it was like, oh, well, I've got something to read, but then I never remembered to go back out and buy the rest, so there is that. So I'm going to be talking about the movie this time, not the graphic novels, but I could possibly touch on the graphic novels a little bit from what I've read. Yeah, fun times. So.
Isn't it true that they made the ending for the movie before the ending for the graphic novel came out?
Yeah, they did. Yeah, so that's pretty cool.
Weird.
Yeah.
Funny how history repeats itself in the form of television for HBO.
Yeah. That is true. Very famous example. Of course, you're talking about The Sopranos, obviously. You know, nothing else comes to mind, really.
Yep.
All right, yes. So, Scott Pilgrim. So, it came out in 2010. Yeah, 2010. It was directed by Edgar Wright, and of course, based on the graphic novel by Brian Lee O'Malley from Canada. Awesome. It was inspired by a plum tree song called Scott Pilgrim. So there you go. That's where the name comes from. From the 90s,
wait,
I believe.
What?
Yeah, yeah.
That's where that came from? It was based off a song of a character in the song named Scott Pilgrim?
Yes.
I mean, there's lots of like musical themes to the film. So, Yeah,
there even is a plum tree song in the movie, too, which is awesome.
I never knew that. When it comes to Scott Pilgrim,
in the comic as well.
I'm like completely blind to like the source material.
Oh yes, yeah. Even has a plum tree shirt on in the I think in the comic as well as in the movie too. So that's pretty cool. Graphic novel, directed by Edgar Wright. Firstly, one of my favorite directors. I think he's fantastic. And it was written by Edgar Wright and Michael Bacall. That's his name. And even has a person that has done some superhero stuff, Bill Pope, as a cinematographer. He also did, I don't know if he did all of the Raimi trilogy. I know he did some of it, but fantastic cinematographer, gotta say. Very good. The story is that, Scott Pilgrim had a bad breakup, and now he's with another girl, Knives Chow, who is only 17 years old. And all of a sudden, he starts seeing this one girl, Ramona, and, you know, this girl just becomes the girl of his dreams, and he starts getting, you know, he's kind of tired of his relationship with Knives. It's not really exactly going anywhere, at least anywhere where he wants it to go. So he starts becoming obsessed with Ramona, and then, you know, he has to juggle two girlfriends. You know, classic Scott Pilgrim stuff right there.
Decide to start a relationship and not tell the first relationship that, I don't think it's working. I'm just going to pretend that this relationship doesn't exist.
Yeah, this is cheat day after all, so it all works out. It's all good. It's a good cheat day.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. In a way, we kind of have the perfect theme for Scott Pilgrim.
Exactly. He decides to he's really interested in Ramona, and eventually she's like, all right, fine, we can date. But in order to date her, he has to fight her seven evil exes, which, you know, very fun stuff there. A lot of super cool action and stuff in the movie and in the comics, of course, too. So, in order to win her heart and to the seven evil exes team up together, and they form this league that is trying to protect Ramona and stuff like that. So it's quite the fun and action-packed story, and the writing is fantastic too. It's very funny and random. There's so many just amazing quotes thrown out just in that movie that just, like, I think about on a daily basis. They're just stuck in my mind that I can never get out of there. They're like a parasite, but it's like a fun parasite though. It's a good parasite.
Yeah, I don't think that movie would have been what it was unless Edgar Wright directed it the way that he does in that movie. Because it's very unique. I don't remember it being like too big, but then again, I wasn't a big fan of Scott Pilgrim at the time. But like the way that he directs it, I don't think it would have been as special as it is unless Edgar Wright was a part of the project, because he's a very specific director when he makes his movies.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, his style fits very well in this, like, the sort of, like, the smooth transitions and stuff, seamless transitions and stuff like that. There's a lot of those present in this movie, which work really well. Like, there's entire scenes where the characters are talking, it's like boom, 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 you know, moving place to place. It has, like, such a fun energy to it. I feel like he was definitely the perfect choice for this movie because of, you know, just the way that he writes movies and stuff like that, and sort of his sense of humor as well as his style fits very well, and it has, like, that sort of comic book feel in the movie. Like, they were told, the actors were told, not to blink and stuff like that, too, because, you know, there's not really any blinking in the comics, at least in Scott Pilgrim.
Well, yeah.
Sometimes, to add realism, perhaps an artist might draw someone blinking, but, yeah, I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, I completely forgot that he told him not to blink.
Keep your eyes open. No blinking.
Yeah, which, like, you know, if it really needed to be kept to the comic style, like, you know, shouldn't all the characters, like, be inflatable to the chibi style that they sort of had in the comics?
That's
as well?
True,
like,
yeah. Unrealistic.
Just give them a whole bunch of, like, hornets and have them stung in their cheeks.
Yes.
Needs That's to be like the comic. Stab, stab, stab.
Michael, I need you to host Stu. I don't think I really kind of want to do this. I prefer not to look like a little cartoon boy.
you already do, so stab, Sorry. Stab, stab.
Who said you had a choice anymore?
You signed a contract, Michael. Now deliver.
Oh, poor Michael.
He didn't see the bee stings anywhere because he was too busy blinking in his off hours.
So. His eyes are just so watery and just so dry, I just couldn't even see anything at that point. Oh, you gotta suffer for your art. One of amazing actors to portray all these different characters. Of course, you got the man himself right before his Captain America debut, Chris Evans, as number two, yeah. Obviously. Fantastic.
Yeah, the stuntman and of the evil exes.
Yes. I love like how they play the universal theme as he's walking out the trailer. That's amazing.
Yeah. All the actor tropes.
Yeah. He cracks his neck to the dum dum.
Yeah. Oh, God. Man.
Hey, Jossie, I relate. I through there now.
I also love that line delivery when he's like, hey, big fan. He's like, why wouldn't you be?
Yes. Oh, man.
He seems nice.
Yeah, and I love Brandon Routh. I mean, it's so.
Oh,
weird.
Yeah. Brandon Routh is probably my favorite out of all of them.
Yeah.
Vegan god.
Yeah, we've got vegan powers. Just
chicken parmesan, is that vegan?
Vegan makes me step.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he also has to be better than everyone else.
Yeah, exactly.
Legendary power.
And I love, like, when the vegan police come in and they take away his powers, like, he's dropping to the floor. It's like, no! And then, like, in the background, there's so much.
Yeah!
They high five.
Yes. Oh, God. Freaking brilliant. Oh, but yeah, so many great performances in that movie. Like, everyone feels like they're perfectly cast and just bring such fun and just, like, feels like they're very dedicated to their roles. So I really appreciate that. And it just makes for such a great time. Just the comedy of the movie is just portrayed perfectly by them. Like, all the lines feel like they're just, like, perfectly said. And, of course, the dramatic moments, too, are very heartfelt as well. So I really appreciate that, too. So yeah, it's just a very fantastically well-made movie, and of course it tries to adapt the graphic novel as accurately as possible. Of course, it takes some liberties, like the ending is different, and also there's more stuff that happens in the graphic novel, of course, because it has more time to do stuff. But I feel like overall they covered a good portion of, even though, like I said, I haven't actually read all of them, so I probably can't say this confidently, but I feel like for the most part, it does follow the comics pretty well. All the important stuff, I feel like, is there. Perhaps there's, like, a few Fred lines here and there that may not be as covered in the comics, but I feel like, though, it's still pretty rock-solid adaptation.
Well, that's awesome, yeah. Do you have, like, a favorite part, or did you have, like, a favorite actor in the movie that you thought, like, really, like, makes the movie shine? Or I take that back. What do you think of Michael C... No, I was going to say Michael C. Hall.
Michael C. Hall.
As Scott Pilgrim. He's like, I have to fight these evil exes to get this girlfriend. Tonight's the night.
At that point, you know, he just becomes the evil ex.
He becomes the tenth one.
Yes.
What do you mean, the first ex? I don't want to fight this man.
I think I kind of want to fight you.
It's like at that point the whole twist of the movie is that he becomes the evil ex. Yeah. He vanquishes them all only to become him.
I'm winning the competition.
Okay, sorry. So what do you think of Michael Sierra as Scott Pilgrim? Do you since I haven't read the graphic novels, do you guys think that he fit the bill perfectly? Because I personally, even though I haven't read them, he to me, he seems like too awkward, like in the position that he's in, I would think that the character, like I said, I could just be like talking out of my ass here, but it seems like to me that the character of Scott Pilgrim would be a little bit less awkward. If that makes any sense.
Yeah, I guess.
And I think that contradiction was always, you know, a brilliant thing for me when I saw it, of just like this awkward guy, but just interluded in between him just kicking everybody's butts.
Yeah, I did appreciate that. You wouldn't expect this guy to be, you know, the hero and stuff to be. He feels like almost in a sense like. Like in any other movie, but perhaps he would be like maybe that sort of awkward sidekick or something, or just like the guy that's there for moral support, like say the Ron Weasley, if you will. But in this case, he is the main character, so I feel like it works really well. I feel like Michael Cera was a good choice. Like it's hard for me to imagine anyone else to play Scott Pilgrim. You know, I'm sure there's probably great actors that could play Scott, but he just feels right for the role, I guess. I don't know, just that awkward energy, I think, is so much fun, and it's really makes the movie for me. Yeah, it's good.
Well, the reason why I ask is because, like, the character goes in. I mean, I know that the fights are supposed to be metaphorical, but since they're performing live, and since Scott Pilgrim does fight in the graphic novels, like physically, they are fighting. I would think that they were like trying to get off like at least of a more confident. Fighter's presence. If I'm wrong about that, correct me. I'm not sure if like Scott Pilgrim's like getting in a fight, he's like, oh wait, can we just talk about this?
Yeah, he kind of did though. That was like the whole thing that he started off with, I think, with the first Evil X's, and I think the first few as well, until he got with the program, of just like, yeah, I kind of had to beat these guys up, I can't convince them of this.
Oh, exactly. Yeah, he comes to a point where he just like, he's like, all right, he just accepts the situation. He's like, all right, fine, I guess I have to fight these guys, so here we go. So yeah.
But he's probably like the fourth Evil X by that point. So.
You're right, yeah, exactly. All right, I got this, I got the whole shtick now, I can do this. So yeah, I feel like that, yeah, he does sort of have that little bit of hesitancy and awkwardness in the beginning. But then, you know, he gradually just gets used to it. It's like, this is the world that he's living in now, so that's what he's doing.
There's I've read a couple of the books. I've probably overread the first two, but from what I remember, when he was, you know, going along the list fighting the X's, he's obviously kind of getting a little bit more drained or not so confident, where he's just like, yeah, let's just get this over with. Like he kind of becomes a piece of shit a little bit.
of course.
Yeah, and of course, it was at the end of the movie or a deleted scene where like Nega Scott came in, which he had a bigger part of in the books. Like he was the id of, well, I would say the interpretation of like he became an evil ex, but
yeah,
you know.
So it was
Michael C. Hall version.
No, Michael C. Hall played Nega Scott.
Yes.
Wasted opportunity.
Oh, that would have been brilliant. But Nega Scott does come in, but he's only just in for just a second. Like after they defeat Gideon, they're like all like, yeah, we did it, and then like they see him come, because he technically becomes an X too, because they break up after the fourth X, I believe, for a moment, and then, you know, they get back together eventually. But then in that instant, he technically counts as an ex, so Nega Scott comes, and they just sort of talk it out, you know, and they agree to get waffles or whatever later down the line. So they just sort of work it out without a fight. We don't see like what they talk about, of course. It's it cuts to like you know, just Scott walking out and just like Knives asks, oh, what happened, you know? He's like, oh, you know, he's just a great guy. So that was fun. But that definitely is a little underplayed. I actually haven't seen the deleted scenes with more of him, but I feel like he probably does have a bigger bigger presence in the comics as well. So, yeah, there's that.
Right.
I still think that's a wasted opportunity to just see Nega Scott right there and just, hello, Scott Pilgrim. I've waited to meet you for a very long time.
Oh, God. That would have been a masterpiece right there.
Yep. It's an opportunity.
The movie's okay, but did you see that ending?
That was crazy, man. That made it for me.
He chopped up Michael Sierra's body everywhere.
Oh, God. Oh, the lost season of Dexter, man.
Yep. It turned out that the real season was just the ending of Scott Pilgrim.
Oh, my goodness. I should have known.
Yep. It was they fit the entire season into, like, 3 minutes.
Or if Nega Scott was Dexter's origins.
Oh, man.
True, it's like the prologue.
Oh, man. Dexter origins coming soon.
Well, anyway, thank you very much for sharing that with us, but we are going to move on. Otherwise, we're going to keep like pushing the
entire podcast to Scott Pilgrim.
More of the story, Scott Pilgrim. Scott anyway.
Pilgrim. Go to your local library and find the story.
Yes. Tell them that the 616th Marvel family, Happy Family, sent you.
Yeah, just go up to a random library and like tell them like, this podcast sent me here. Have you ever heard of it? No.
No.
Oh my God, sponsored by libraries.
Yep. So just get a book and get out.
We don't care about your podcast.
Can you talk to me?
I've never seen you in here before. Do you live in this neighborhood? No, but I was told to go to the library. Get out. Get out. Oh, now.
True, you're tragic too.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we are going back to the wheel, but now it has become the wheel of torture because Ooh. We are going to find out who is my least favorite person of the day, and they get to talk next. So as we click on the wheel, we are going to find out who gets to talk next and who I get to berate.
Aha.
Oh no, Victor!
Oh!
You're my least favorite person of the day!
Dang.
Why would you do that?
You son of a bitch!
Yeah, you son of a bitch!
Oh, no.
Damn. I betrayed you. I'm sorry.
Oh, no.
You were my brother, Victor! I loved you!
Yep. I'm sorry, but I failed you completely.
Oh, no. This is a sad day.
Yep.
Anyway, right. So please continue in telling us which character that you're going to talk to us today that is not Batman.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm not talking about Batman. In fact, I'm not talking about anybody in the DC universe this time around. Last time, yeah, it was the Sandman and Wonder Woman. But this time, I'm not going to be talking about them.
Twist.
I'm actually going to take a picture, page out of the Fighting Hatter's book from the first episode that we had a cheat day on. Or sort of Marvel adjacent, in a way. And I will explain the context with that later, but for now, the pick of my choice is NBC's Heroes.
Oh, that's a show I haven't heard about in years.
Yeah, so.
Yep. Days of the early 2000s. I transport you back. but yeah, I watched it like with the first episode with me discussing Lucifer. I watched it like with like shows I missed across like 2020 and 2021. It was just sort of like a period of like watching stuff that I never watched before. That everybody like already watched and, you know, enjoyed or didn't enjoy or whatever. And, you know, I got to check out now. And Heroes is among that list of the superhero stuff of old that I missed, and now I get to check out and rib on or enjoy. In this case, it was a bit of both. It was an interesting adventure. Where it's basically a superhero anthology about not really superheroes, but rather people with extraordinary abilities. But they aren't mutants. They're not.
I was about to say, Victor, you're crossing. You're about to cross the line here.
Yeah,
getting close to mutants.
No, they're called Evos.
Victor, you're getting close.
Do you smell that? I love watching.
Yeah. And so, yeah, with these people, they're hunted down, but instead of with a certain other property, they're hunted down with a normal person and another superhuman person who is basically just brought along against their will for servicing our human overlords to look for these people. Yeah, this anthology story follows a few individuals throughout the story, starting, of course, with a scientist, Mohinder Suresh, who narrates the story because they basically just abuse him for his narration. We don't get too much focus on him. Like, mostly it's in like the early half of the series and season 3, but that's kind of it. But like most of the time he doesn't even appear in an episode sometimes. And he's just there to narrate it.
He's like there. We're not going to show you him, but he's there.
He's just right he's out there of frame. He's just there.
What was it like the Peacemaker thing to where like in the end like the Justice League show up but like half of their faces you can't see half of their faces because they're in shadow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we don't really have a situation like that because there's not really any iconic heroes of this thing. Like there's no superheroes in this exactly. There are just people like in this world with a company a hunting them down. And a serial killer tracking each one of them one by one.
So there's not really like superheroes per se, but like they're just people with powers.
Yeah. Okay. And there are supervillains. Those exist, but there is
that no doesn't make sense. How could there be supervillains but not superhero? Oh wait, never mind. That's swinging too close to home. Anyway, continue.
Well, yeah, I mean, even then, they don't, like, it's not like they get the costumes and the, like, protagonists don't, but, like, it's a case where, like, the one super villain of the show, like, has an alter ego known as Siler, who is, of course, like, the iconic guy played by Spock from the latest Star Trek trilogy. Zachary Quinto. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Zachary Quinto, his iconic roles. A couple of these survivors looking to survive not being killed by him, they are a collection of guys. There's a precognitic painter who of course predicts a like end of the world scenario of a nuke in New York. Of course, this painter is named Isaac. There is Hero, a time traveler, who of course uses his powers to be one of the first to catch on with this world-ending threat. There is Peter and Nathan Petrelli, brothers. One mimics powers and one can fly. That's basically his only thing. Spoilers, the flight does not really come up that much. His main thing is being a politician. that's his true superpower. And yeah, like the East Collection and the heroes are mainly who you got throughout the series. The painter does not play a part later on, but he does play a part like at least initially to bring these guys together. Those are of course the main guys. Oh yeah, and of course Greg Grunberg. Actually plays a mind reader later on, who does play a role. Reads minds, which does come in handy as well. Matt Parkman being his name. Claire Bennett. That's the other final player who heals, basically Wolverine levels of healing.
Oh.
And Dr. Suresh and Isaac, they are mainly the normals of the bunch. Mahindra Suresh being like the scientist that knows about these particular powered individuals. Not really named until their 2015 reboot, where the Evo's name that I mentioned comes into play. And yeah, it does basically become X-Men very transparently by that point.
Okay, so before Victor names literally every character in the show, will you please just give us a... I'm messing with you, but...
Sorry. that was a very disjointed way of, like, naming it. But yeah, like, essentially these characters come from, like, entirely different backgrounds each. One helps like old folks home. One is just like your standard or teenage cheerleader. One is a police officer. You know, it's like a ton of different, you know, motives and placements for each, which definitely allows the serial killer known as Siler the upper hand initially. Though the interesting thing here with time travel playing an angle is that each season of the show, and especially the first one that sets that concept up, basically sets up this alternate timeline where things go entirely wrong for everyone. Like, you know, you do have like an entirely alternate path that like changes the history for these like superpowered individuals and like potentially could doom the world. Which, like, has the show's, like, initial tagline, which is save the cheerleader, save the world.
Okay, so every season they're basically trying to save the world?
Yeah, every single season, that's what they do. And, like, yeah, the first one is the sort of unclear task of, like, how do you save an unkillable, like, person? It's like, cheerleader is unkillable. And yet somehow has died in this alternate timeline that changes everything.
Dang.
And like the whole old deal when it comes to what allows for their discovery and stopping him is that the serial killer basically absorbs powers. That is his whole thing. He is a watchmaker, which gets his supervillain name from the very watches that he designs. Like there's a Siler being the name of the watch that he like works on, that is what starts his supervillain spree of basically taking powers from other people.
Oh, so like an evil version of Rogue.
Yeah, except instead of touching people, he basically just like cuts their heads open and then like. Just sort of digs in for their superpowers.
Where are your superpowers? Is he like digging through their guts?
Gotta be here somewhere, come on.
Yeah, that's mainly like the plan there.
I was more thinking when the orc got decapitated. Looks like meat's back on the menu.
Yeah.
It's essentially like a whole bunch of like followers, like a whole bunch of henchmen that he purposely made into cannibals. He's like, here you go, boys. I don't need these parts.
I should have watched more of a season if that happened.
The thing that causes them to end up like beating him is that like not only does he absorb their superpowers, he also absorbs like their weaknesses of said superpowers.
Okay. Oh. Well, at least that evens things out. Otherwise, like, how do we kill this guy?
I guess we're screwed.
I mean, most of the time they are. Like, he's kind of just like this unkillable guy to the point where, like, one thing that they had to do to, like, you know, stop him was to make him think that he was good. Like, that was like.
What?
Yeah, they like. Like the mimic Peter Petrelli and like his brother, like one of the later season and threats, like just made him think that he was a relative of those two, basically just to keep him under control. It's like the train. This universe also has like a group, like an Illuminati type a society of these superpowered individuals that existed long before these main characters. There's like a type of like edge to that factor being there, like the parents of all these different characters.
You thought you were in control this entire time, didn't you?
They're sort of like the Justice Society of like this group of heroes.
We're the Justice Society of all nations. So we can't get sued.
By now.
Yeah, like, yeah, they sort of had that vibe, even though, like, yeah, half the characters are named after, like, you know, Christian folk heroes. Like, they do have this notion that this is, like, geographically international in some ways. For instance, like, yeah, the time traveler is, of course, from Japan.
Isn't his name actually Hero, too, in the show?
Yeah, his name is Hero, so it's less in the Christian folkware or naming scheme that the rest of the characters have, and more just the theme of the show. His name is Hero, and the show's name is Heroes.
Oh,
it's a show.
Oh, that is dumb.
It's terrible that the only other thing I recognized that actor in was the 2 seconds in Balls of Fury when he gets kicked into a bathroom stall.
I mean, I'm impressed. Like, I recognize, like, extras sometimes like that, so yeah, I'm definitely impressed with that find.
Is that, like, one of the, are you talking about, like, is that one of, like, the sex slaves in Balls of Fury?
No, he wasn't a sex slave. He was, like, a bathroom. Oh. I wish it was with Deirdre Bader in that scene.
For anybody listening, the context of the, like, Balls of Fury, it's like a movie to where, like, they play ping pong like in extreme way, and like there's, and like Christopher Walken's like an emperor like somewhere, and his sex slaves, he's like, I have sex slaves, and it turns out like they're all like athletic men.
Yeah, he's like the head.
Yeah.
And weirdly enough, I recognize these people from like J.J. Abrams productions and like ABC shows.
How dare you?
Mainly those two.
I was gonna ask if, because that sounded familiar to me, like if J.J. Abrams was a part of like the writing team for Heroes.
He wasn't actually.
Oh, he wasn't?
It's weird. They just get like his crew.
Everyone but him. So come with us.
Yeah. Hey, JJ, we're gonna have to work with your team for a bit. It's like, oh yeah, cool. When do I start? Let's do this. Well, that's the neat part. You don't.
Yeah, they just like he was like distracted with the loss, and then they just stole all of his veterans.
Wait, where's my crew? Guys, wait, come back.
Take your little Star Wars toys, JJ. We don't need you.
Okay, I'll make my own story with this, and that's how it happened.
That was how Lost happened. It was called Filipinos.
That's how Lost and Star Wars happened.
Out Lost. But, it was gone.
When it comes to JJ, he can get a little lost.
Just a little.
Yeah, it is kind of true that Hero is sort of like the central character of the show, not because like time travel is the central theme of the show and that is its power, but like also he runs into the Stan Lee cameo. So that's what I meant when I said that this does tie back to Marvel at some point.
There it is.
It's one of those many non-Marvel productions where he appears. Like, yes.
Hey, that's actually quite an interesting franchise you got there. It kind of looks familiar, if I'm being honest with you.
I'm gonna cameo! Excelsior!
You know, I'll keep my mouth shut if you'll just let me walk in on set, you know? If I get in front of a camera, things just happen, you know? Just let things happen.
But if you say no, I can leave the cease and desist with you.
I'll just leave this little present with you. You can open it when I'm off set.
And, like, yeah, like, the thing that's interesting about it is that a lot of these, like, third-party productions, like, for one thing, this is the one that isn't a comic book. Like, a lot of the time, no, they are based on like other third-party comic productions, like, and this started in TV, rather than the opposite that would happen with like a lot of third-party properties. Like, they were trying to make the next superhero third-party, but in a different way than everyone else. And, like, I find that as very, like, interesting. And another factor, like, with a lot of these superhero third parties, a lot of them draw off of, like, DC in terms of, like, their notion of superheroes. Like, you'd have your Justice League and, like, you know, your characters with tights, you're very much Batman XP and your Superman or, you know, anything like that. That is typically what you'd have in a superhero show or a superhero third-party comic. You know, Invincible, you know, with Blood Unshot, you know, all these different properties typically would have something very DC-like if they are being done, to be honest. Which makes sense. There are, like, a template for works with tightites in terms of parody and then switching it on its head of being more like the straight-laced ones. I think it's a little harder to do so when you're doing it for Marvel, considering that they are very much, you know, the alter ego first, rather. You know, humans trying to be gods rather than the opposite. And that is the case here. Like, it's very much focused on the alter egos because there is no superhero costumes and stuff. Like, their primary reference material for a lot of these characters is, of course, from the Marvel front. Like, their reference at its point is the X-Men when referencing, like, some of their, like, superpowers. Like, you know, when they're, like, talking about the cheerleader, for instance, whose power is super healing, they do bring up Wolverine. Because, you know, that is kind of an obvious point to go from. And, like, yeah, the painter who, of course, brings them all together, the way he does it is that his business is, that he does while painting is writing, like, comic books about all these people that he's, like, has precognitive powers of. So, like, heroes literally have to, like, read these comics about themselves in order to, like, piece the story together.
That's pretty cool.
And that's an interesting way to incorporate, like, the sense of the world like that, especially, like, if they're, like, comparing the, like, already made comic book characters into comic books to kind of translate, I'd say translate, like, those heroes into being viewed as superheroes. But as much as I'd like to let you keep talking about it, we do have to start switching turns here, but we talking about heroes. It's a show that definitely should not be forgotten. We need to put that back into
very important. The,
it's a very important piece of superhero history that needs to be reinstated. There we go. That's the word. That's the word I like. We'll use that one.
Vocabulary word of the day.
It's like 6 years ago that they had the revival, but yeah, I think having a reboot or something would be a cool idea.
That would be cool, like a years later or something.
Yeah, that was more a continuation, though. That's where they were called Evos instead of unnamed.
It was the soft
universe.
But anyway, we're going to go back to the wheel and find out who gets to talk next. They're not necessarily my favorite person, nor are they my least favorite person, but they are indeed a person. So we're going to find that out by spinning the wheel. Thank you again, Victor. But to the wheel. Who gets to talk next? There we go. Oh, look. A celebration has been made on my computer. The Poppet gets to talk next.
Alright, so not a lot of pressure on me. First time doing something like this.
No pressure.
Pressure at all.
Lots of pressure.
Oh god, it's crushing. Okay, so I was told a couple days ago to come onto the podcast and think of what is my favorite comic. It was kind of a battle between the two, but I'm going to go for the second more obscure one, because the first one, that would probably be a whole couple hours of me running through. But my character for a cheat day I was going to select is one named Marco. He is from the series called Saga, which is ran by Image Comics. Now, not a lot of people know about Saga, but I'm pretty sure you might recognize, like, the pop figures that were that was gathering gut dust for years in the back of your local Hot Topics. But it's, yeah, it's one of those things where it's everywhere if you look for it, but it's nowhere if you don't look for it. But it's, in my opinion, it's a pretty good story. It is a Brian K. Vaughan made story. I know he's done other projects, but they're not coming to mind, but he's pretty prolific in the Image comic world. The art is done by Fiona Staples, which I believe she's done some cover art for some DC covers. Again, I can't think of any examples. But a character I'm going to focus on is going to be one of the main protagonists named Marco. A little bit of context of how the story goes. In Brian K. Vaughan's words, it's a space opera, or just a whole... it's a sci-fi story of survival, war, passion, and a lot of fucking. A lot of fucking, a lot of drugs.
Oh, yeah, that I heard about.
Sextillion. So, take that as you will. It's a prostitute planet. It's fantastic.
Get it? It's a play on words for you smart people out there.
But with Marco, let's start off with how this story began. There's a war, obviously, between a main planet and a moon planet. The moon planet is known as Wraith. This is where the character I was going to focus on came from, Marco. They are like the crap of the land rule types of people, but they work with magic. And the main planet is ran by another planet, if my brain can remember what that one was called. But that main planet, you know, that one is technologically advanced. They absolutely despise the Wraith planet. Reasons aren't coming to mind of how the war started, but let's just say war started. Read it yourself to figure out how it happened. Now the people on the main planet are, well, they're humans too, but they have these bug-like wings. The character design was very easy on the eyes to start with, but then later on the series they get more creative, more animalistic looking humanoid aliens. So with Marco on the opposing side of the war and the female of this story named Elena, she was a prison guard, captured Marco, they fell in love, gross, they fucked, they made a kid. This kid isn't supposed to exist. This kid is the product of two opposing sides, and both planets find out about the kid and they want everyone in this family to be dead. So the entire story is just them going through a space odyssey, traveling through different planets, the types. Sextillion is one that was involved with another person, I guess. And try and think on this here. It's a story that's been in the making for nearly 10 years. They recently just got back into syndication because of a lot of, hiatuses. Their biggest one that happened was back in 2018, and they were going to come back in 2021, but pandemic, so they came back a couple months ago. So there's that.
You weren't supposed to describe the plot of Star Wars, right?
Well, Brian doesn't like when you bring it up that it is based from Star Wars. He gets a little sensitive on that, from what I hear.
Guys, it's not Star Wars. It's not sex Star Wars.
It's Star Wars, but they say fuck.
see, Dune, they say a fuck in that. That's not like Star Wars, right?
But do they have television-headed people fucking in the third page of the book? Actually, yeah. When you start reading the book, it's a live birth. But it's not like from the side or like a view of like, oh, look, it's happening. No, the first page you open up to is her vagina pushing out this kid. It's like, oh, it's going to be one of those stories. It's not going to censor it at all.
What, like in the graphic novel, like their censorship is just three black lines.
Oh, that there is no censorship. There's good. Dicks, tits, anything that you can imagine, even with these animalistic humanoid ones. It's like, oh shit, that wolf chick, she has eight tits. Awesome.
Whoa.
Why are they all around? I don't like this anatomy.
Oh,
it's not accurate.
They need to be bigger.
How can we improve on this character? Bigger. Make them all bigger.
Get the Sharpie.
yeah.
I'd say I'd select Marco, because there's a lot of different ideologies between the dynamic of Marco and Elena. Elena is the more do now, think later of the consequences, to where Marco is a person that steps back, sees the whole picture, and is the more cautionary one. You know, he's the brains instead of the full bronze between the two. I forgot where I was for a second.
What? Speak up.
I don't remember.
Answer the question.
Okay, so because he grew up from like a farmstead land, he is very much someone that I would say isn't too familiar with the technological advancements of this current type of galaxy location, but he is
Skywalker. Sorry, I had that set.
Poor mouth.
In my throat.
But he is someone that thinks quick on his feet. He's someone that's. Sorry, I was about to repeat myself. My brain ain't working. Nope.
He's good on his feet.
Did I mention? He's fantastic with his feet.
No, you didn't.
No, you're good. He is a fighter, but he is a gladiatorial fighter. Like, he has the big round shield and giant sword. He was abused as a child. They made that the first opening page of the second issue, where it's like, oh yes, a child in a field. And oh shit, a father is beating him.
Ah, yes.
Let's meet the parents at the end of this issue.
Hey son, what did the bat say to the child? Whack!
Yeah, Batman would be brought up today.
We weren't going to speak back
to the man.
Yeah.
But I could go all day with the comics, but I'm not sure of how much I'm supposed to let on of the story, because it's a story that's been made with 10 years behind its belt, and more to come since they're only halfway through the series.
Ooh.
So with this parent duo leading them out in the galaxies and whatnot, just trying to survive, there's bounty hunters after them. As I mentioned, the TV head robots is one of them. He's pretty cool, but he's a ball of PTSD and repressed sexual issues, so I don't know if there's much to talk about that dude.
An incel.
Oh my god, you're right.
is an incel.
does he hate women?
I think Prince Robot's supposed to be gender fluid. Like, there's this big story plot that, like, when him and his battalion in the war thought they were gonna die, they had, like, a big-ass orgy. And he has a wife and a kid on the way in the beginning of the series, but he's, like, coping or groping with that, where he's like, I don't need this single life. I need to live. I need to dance.
I wanna dance. He says it like as they're fighting a giant battle. He's just like right in the middle of all that fighting, he finds Jesus.
I mean, already this guy seems like my favorite character. Oh, I haven't even read this book yet.
Oh no, I can touch up on him too. He's pretty cool. He is kind of a slime bag. Like, he would throw you under a bus if it means he can get a fucking cracker, but he doesn't have a mouth, so how is he going to eat it? That's the type of guy he is. He's also a deadbeat dad at one point where, you know, he went on the mission to hunt down this family, and he didn't come back after, am I allowed to say spoiler stuff or?
Just say spoiler before saying the spoiler. Don't say the spoiler, then say, oops, spoilers.
I should have. Spoilers, by the way. Like a real asshole.
Yeah.
It would be memorable.
I mean, I don't exactly want to have Kevin Smith around here again. So yeah. Spoilers.
So many times.
Yeah. Well, spoiler. The wife gets killed with another TV head dude. I think he was like a janitor or a butler guy. So he ends up killing Prince's Robot's wife, kidnaps the son, and with Prince Robot, you know, he found out the child was born and not the murder or the kidnapping. So he decides to go to Sextillion because, you know, the sex planet kind of ties into the plot a lot. And he doesn't find out until months later, and then he's like, maybe I should be a dad and hunt after this kid. But then again, I do need to hunt after this family. What to do? Anyway, let's go to the other story plot.
Sex plant seems like a real place of contemplation in this book.
It does. Oh,
yeah. Let's just go to the paradise planet to think things over.
Yes. Well, my soul's getting sucked off for months on end. That's pretty much what happens in that part. And, you know, I believe because he's a fan favorite, that's kind of the reason. He was kind of shoehorned in to team up with the parent family unit. I don't know why I keep spacing out the word family.
Family.
Get out of here, Dawn! Go back to your closet!
You don't need a closet when you got... Just close the
door. I beg to differ in a few cases.
He opened the closet, he's not there.
How does he do that every single time?
It's amazing. The card is like, he just drives away fast.
Huh. All right.
That's what this episode should have been about, just Don Toretto the entire
That's
time.
That's true, yeah. He's not part of the Marvel Universe, I don't think.
Not yet.
We'll see where Doctor Strange 2 is.
Well, if you actually of Endgame, there's an Easter egg in the distance. If you really squint your eyes. If you listen closely, you can hear,
Fam.
It's been a long... I guess it's part of the universe. Cool.
Yeah, Dom Toretto, in the background, is a blink and you'll miss it moment, but he takes his car and takes on an entire whale of the Chitauri.
Canon.
Don, you can't take out this whale! What with family? I can't.
You don't leave the adventure.
So, outdated meme aside, Prince Robot was made to team up actually with Marco. Let's bring that character back.
Mm.
He was brought back to team up with Marco because Elena and Child was kidnapped by a mercenary group, I think. And I guess they bond over, have an understanding of, hey, we have kids. Let's put our petty bullshit aside and save our kids.
For the kids.
And they did. So then, Prince Robot was excommunicated. So then he's just Robot the Fifth.
Fifth robot of all of existence.
So yeah.
Prince Robot becomes Robot.
Fifth.
Can't forget the fifth.
IV. Yeah.
You have been stripped of your prince title. Huh, I gotta make myself stand out somehow. The Fifth. That's my last name now.
Yeah, they'll get ladies.
Back to the sex planet.
No, I think we stay away from the sex planet after he left. We might go back to that later with the upcoming issues, which I think the next one is coming out next month.
Yeah, no wonder everyone's hyped.
Yeah, I'm following the series as it's coming out right now, but it's also one of those, the comic can be very good. It's a problem when you read it in issues, because when you read it in issues, one can be very dramatic, very bombastic, and then the next one is, it feels like, okay, it's not as grabby or attention pulling, but I don't think that should be with every one, because then you're setting an expectation. But I feel like that expectation was set with, well, a lot of the beginning series, and with the hiatus now ending, people are expecting bigger and better. So, that is that. But
the expectations are always raised with more time.
Yeah.
Between projects.
Oh yeah, no, it definitely takes time to make such a piece, and if you're familiar with Fiona Staples' work, it's, you know, a lot of detail. She's come a lot of ways from the series when they started 10 years ago, and you can obviously see the art has changed and gotten more detailed, and, you know, it's very colorful, it's very good, very sharp,
pretty.
Very sharp and soft, yes. But yeah, no, so between the two of Prince Robot and Marco, they kind of have this, we're at a truce, but I will throw you under a bus for a cracker at any moment, which with Prince Robot, he does. I don't want to give away that part of how he becomes a barnacle scum.
Then don't.
Then I won't. So I think I'm going to end my turn right there, unless if anyone had any questions, I can answer it to the best of my ability or half-assed as I can.
Sure, yeah. What got you into this comic?
I think a part of it was from a friend, but I think another part of it is seeing the goddamn Funko Pops in the back of Hot Topic, and I'm like, what the fuck is this from? And when I was with this friend at the time, he's like, let me sit you the fuck down. And he had, he had like the first 40-something, and I binge read them through 4 or 5 days. I go back to his place, and he's like, what do you think about them? And I'm like, when the fuck is the next issue coming out?
We like that line from Malcolm in the Middle when like the dad like goes to Malcolm's like, are you sure you really, really want to know about this? You do. There's no turning back. And he's like, and he's like, neat. We'll start tomorrow.
Know what I was gonna fall into. And, you know, he was also kind of like, oh, there's a lot of boobies in this book. And I'm like, well,
oh no,
I got a lot of boobies when I look down, so it's fine. It's fine.
I don't know. I'm still trying to process this. I'm kind of going off the edge here, man.
Oh God!
You're following my somebody. Good Christian brain.
Yep. That'd be the edge, typically.
That's the line that we're gonna draw the sand in.
Read the first issue. I gotta go to the sex plan. I'll be back.
That's like the theme of this episode.
More of the story. Sex planet, yay or nay?
I would say yay and nay, because there's a lot of like experimental aliens there. But there's a subsection on this planet that sells like child prostitutes, so it's like, fuck. But the rest of it, though.
It's that one section. We don't go to that section. The rest, though, it's all good.
No. I mean, if it helps, the pimp was like, you know, killed in what, the 4th, 5th panel he was in.
Hey. Did that stop the distribution?
Probably. I don't think they've seen any other child prostitutes in the series after that dude died.
Hey, alright.
Hopefully. Yep. It's like all the kids like run off. It's like, yay, we're free, and they go to another planet and like they make like an entire like theme park. They're like, where did you get your start? Child prostitution! Oh!
Oh my god! Oh, I thought this place was happy!
It is happy! Now!
Oh, man. Yep.
Did you guys have any questions for Poppet over here before we pop off to the next... I know what you're thinking. You're not funny.
Nah, I would have found that funny.
I recommend reading the series. You can get like the first. Yeah, you can get.
That was the one thing I was asking. Just the obvious of like, you know. Would you recommend this?
I would recommend it if you have the stomach for, well, for one, a lot of the nudity, a lot of the drugs and violence and the curses of whatnot.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, they're cursing in it? Fuck no, I'm out.
I'm not. You lost me there, you lost me.
They say the C word rhymes with Helen Hunt.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
My eyes.
Please. Helen Bunt.
Canceled.
Oh, no.
What have you done?
You're going to cancel it. No. Cancel it on Twitter.
You can read it online. You can buy the physical prints at your local Barnes and Nobles. Again, not sponsored.
It's not sponsored because she said Barnes and Nobles.
Barnes and Nobles.
That's the copyright free version.
At the local library once, and when I checked it out and sent it back, it never was put back. And I'm like, I think they found out.
They're
what
like,
this
oh,
was.
What is this one here?
Why are some of the pages here attached to each other?
I think with that whole book, it would be just a brick. You drop it.
You know, I find it funny that in like libraries, there's like a whole bunch of books that come in, and like you can obviously tell that the librarians, they don't check the books for some exactly, reason. And it's like, because like I remember like going into like one library, it's completely off topic, but like I go in one library and I saw like a whole bunch of like these Japanese cartoon books. And I'm like, what is this? Excuse me, and it's like a. Yes, it's like, are these guys your books? And like, they look at it, and then they look to the side, and then her eyes are open wide, and she sees on the side and it says like their sticker. I'm like, nope, this is a mistake, young man. I'm very glad that you pointed this out. I think someone left their book here. Thank you for pointing these out.
Personal collection, get out here.
Whoops, that's from my house. I mean, no, that's from somewhere else. Let me just take that back real quick.
Oh, I bought these for my son. We were going to read them together.
He just loves his Japanese cartoons.
We love these Japanese cartoons.
That'll just be the excuse, I guess, that I go to the library.
Now go. The library's closed.
Yeah.
Everyone get out. The library's over.
Except my son. Okay, we're getting really off topic. We're going back.
Okay, good stuff. Good, very good stuff. Thank you very much for sharing your comic book and characters with us. But now we're going to move on to the last person, which is me. But since I'm the last person, we're going to find out if I am the least or the most according to the wheel. And it doesn't really matter. It just makes me feel bad if I'm the least. Ooh. But today, that is not that day. I am the last and the most. I am the host with the most. Host the only the most that is the most.
Oh, shit.
Hooray!
So, I'll try to be quick about this because we're going to be pushing up to an hour and a half in a minute.
You got 2 seconds. Go.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks
for listening.
Crap,
go.
I learned so much.
Okay. So the character I would like to introduce, if you haven't heard of him, picture, if you will, the year is something in the future, AD, and everything sucks in the future because crime is at an all-time high, and there are so many people that are committing crimes, they have to make their police force more brutal. So, what do they call their police force? Judges. What do these judges do? They kick ass and murder criminals. Welcome to the world of Judge Joseph Dread.
Oh yeah, man.
Insert
explosion. I am the law.
So, Judge Dread is a character that was introduced. I forgot which year, but through Eagle Comics, comics I don't think I've actually ever heard of before. But the point of Judge Dread is as I mentioned, the future sucks. Crime is very, very high. So what they do is they get these police officers called judges to find criminals, and they will dictate how high their crime is. But like felonies and misdemeanors are like at a very large definition. Like if you litter, you can get like sentenced to like the rest of your life into like one of their jail cells, which is like it's like a box. It doesn't have windows. You're just like placed basically into a box like forever. Like you have the possibility of getting like parole and whatnot, but like the possibility of doing so is very, very low. So everything sucks. And if you like, I don't know, like just carry a gun or like shoot somebody like even once, they basically have authorization to kill you. It is that brutal and it is that harsh in this world. And the city that Judge Dredd lives in, because everybody was at war with themselves, is one mega city, so like everybody lives in one gigantic city, and if you don't live there, you're basically like an outcast or like a mutant or whatever, and not X-Men mutants, just to make that very clear. I was crossed
at
the
least
line
compared
there.
To mine, like, you know, yours actually were called mutants. I do remember that. And
so it's a very harsh reality, like a version of Earth. But the thing that struck me interesting about Dread is that in the world of Dread is that it gets really weird. And not maybe like Doctor Strange weird, but it gets like the world itself gets really weird because you're probably thinking, if you've never heard of Judge Dredd before, he's kind of like a very extreme version of RoboCop if he wasn't a cyborg. But they have psychics in the lore. They have a whole bunch of like Judge Dredd's arch nemesis is literally called Judge Death, who basically becomes the Grim Reaper through like witches that are like reminiscent of like the ones from Macbeth. So there's magic that's introduced into all of like the world of Judge Dredd when it's basically just supposed to be a harsh reality version of LA, I guess. But the main question that gets brought up with Judge Dredd is like, how harsh is harsh? Is what they're doing really for the benefit of the United States or like whatever the United States have evolved into? It's like, is what they do really working, and is it worth it? Like, in the name of preserving justice and holding out the law. Because, as I mentioned before, everything is just so brutal. Everything is so violent. It just doesn't seem like things are getting better. It just seems that things are just getting worse and just becoming more brutal for the citizens that live in this gigantic mega city. So, that's basically a wrap-up. That's me just trying to be fast before we have to log off. But do you guys have any questions or any memories of Judge Dredd? Because like one of my favorites is watching the movie that came out recently in 2012.
That's
yeah, I remember both versions actually, but yeah, primarily I think I had a watch of the reboot rather recently. Was the newer one with Carl Urban?
Yeah,
that's amazing.
Yeah, it was kind of like, yeah, it was basically like a self-contained story in one building for the most part, aside from like the initial prologue.
Yeah, it was, if you've ever seen the Raid movies, it's basically one of those movies, but yeah. Like, he has a gun that nobody can touch. Yeah, that's another thing too, the judges, they have like their own personal gun, so they can like do like a whole bunch of stuff, and if you try picking it up, it's gonna blow your hand off because it's not your fingerprints. That's awesome.
Yeah, there's a lot of
fingerprinted guns.
Yeah, a lot of really cool technology and lore and stuff in that series. So
that's... I need that, but with personal items. Like,
you touch myself while your hand is gone.
My room.
Yeah. I mean, I think the only flaw with them is like they announce like when you run out of ammo, which was really a big flaw in that film. and like. The guy, I knew, like, when and that happened, and he was facing Judge Dredd, which kind of had him be a bit screwed there.
Regular ammo. You are out of ammo. What was that?
Nothing. I'm totally not out of ammo.
I'm just refilling my ammunition. The law's gonna get you. I am the law.
You have none in your pockets.
There seems to be extra ammunition lying on the ground on the other side of the room. God damn it, shut up!
I would love if there's a big shootout. And what was happening during the shootout? It's like, oh, I'm gonna get one of these I'm gonna get one of you guys. And when Judge Dredd is about to shoot, out of ammo, what'd your gun say? Oh, nothing.
Oh,
it didn't say anything at all.
And he just throws the gun at them. He's like, here, catch. And then it blows up.
That could work.
Hey.
It might. Yeah, you can't really bait criminals there in this world because machinery is a little too honest.
Ben, we have a new tactic. Just throw your guns at them. It's a lot quicker. Saving the money on ammunition.
It's a win.
Cleanup's just... the cleanup will be taken care of by another group. Don't worry about the brains on the wall.
I mean, they'd have to blow out the brains anyway, even if they had ammunition, so...
Yeah.
True.
As well, both. blow them up either way. Yep.
Go ahead.
I was gonna say, though, like, in the Dredd movie, he does... he basically just kills everybody, but there's like a lot of like cool kills in it. And like, there's a drug that's introduced in the movie. I don't know how prevalent this is to the source material and the comic books, but it's called Slow-Mo, and it's self-explanatory. But you smoke it, and like everything from your perspective is like in slow motion and colorful, blah 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 blah. And like one of my favorite kills is in the end, like the person who's running the trade, who's like basically like the kingpin of slow-mo, is what's her name, Cersei from Game of Thrones.
Mama. That was her title. That was literally what Mama. They called her.
Mama. Judgment time. But what he does is like he gets up to Mama, and because he's killed everybody in the building,
everybody's dead. Men, except on the lower levels, because like they were like quarantined in their rooms.
Yeah, yeah.
Basically, in order to not get involved in all this.
Yeah. So if you are in your room, you're safe. But if you are outside, you are definitely not going to be alive.
No.
But in the end, he gets up to Mama, and like he like shoves like the drug in her mouth, so it's like she's taking slow-mo, and he shoves her out of like the window of like the tallest part of the building, and like she's falling to her death. But everything is just going slow, until like her head just like hits the floor and just like bursts like a balloon everywhere. It's awesome.
Nice.
It's a classic.
Definitely has to earn like the best death of it all. The one thing that was like, like the whole like ambiguity of the film was like she was set to blow up the building, like if she died, and like he still threw her off.
He's like, I don't care about this building, man.
Remember, kids, drugs kill, and he like puts it in her mouth and shoves her out the window.
Where are those PSAs? I need those in my life. Yeah. Not even once.
Judge Dredd should do our PSAs from now on.
Yeah, all PSA messages have to be Judge Dredd related, and he like kills like the person that's like committing the crime, just as the example. It's like, wait a minute, this was just an example. You have just violated the law.
I swear, this isn't even real alcohol. I don't care.
The law says that you can't have it past 5:30.
And it is, check to watch, 5:32.
Yeah, that's also like one of the things too, like I miss, but like the reason why they're called judges is because they act as judge, jury, and executioner. Yeah. So he will like so judges are supposed to like, before they kill you or they arrest you, they are supposed to like tell you like what your crimes are. He's like, this is punishable by death. Okay, bang. And like one of my other favorite kills in like the movie too was like he has like this form of ammunition called Hot Shot that like it's you shoot
oh, yeah,
it
from the opening. Yeah,
it melts whatever like you shoot it at. So he like says Hot Shot, it activates, and he pulls the trigger, and then he shoots this guy like right in the mouth, and it melts his entire head onto his shoulders.
Nice.
Oh,
it's like amazing. What do you have? What kind of crime do you have to commit to where a judge melts your entire head off?
Definitely a jaywalker right there.
It's pretty obvious to me, isn't it?
What?
Movie piracy.
Movie piracy.
You illegally recorded a movie that was still within theaters that was not under your property. The sentence is melting face off.
It was only Sonic 2, I swear.
Tony had no POV options. That's no excuse.
Hot Shot. What? I said Hot Shot.
Oh. Daddy, no!
You want to join him?
The kids wanted to see the movie, so they pushed him to commit the crime. So is he going to hot shot the kids?
Ooh.
Depends if he sees him as a victim or a criminal.
They really pushed their dad. Like, they were hitting him and shit. They were
I don't know. We might have to get the hot shot.
We have to see this movie on the laptop, or else we're going to tell mommy that you beat us.
Yeah, they're criminals.
Oh, yeah. They're judged.
Oh man. Yeah, it's like total justice move there. Dread. Oh, yeah.
Justice will prevail as like little kids are dying with their heads being melted.
I shouldn't scoff at the crime.
You gotta remember, kids, crime doesn't pay. Bum, 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 bum.
If you don't wanna do the time, don't do the crime. Hot shot. What? Just warning shots them in the shoulder.
Like make their entire arm fall off.
That was a warning shot.
I had to disarm you. I'll leave.
I told you to drop that pirated DVD. And he's like, he goes to like his own apartment. It's like, it only seems it's like it's getting worse up there. What am I doing wrong? There's like 10 dead kids in the street. The city is sick and it needs me.
I'm the cure.
That ruins the end narration with the day-to-day that Judge Dredd does.
I was thinking that would be the beginning.
Yes.
The beginning.
And he just like murders like an entire set of like politicians, and you like everybody's like, yay! It's like the city loves me, and like now the whole government is like in flat.
Is it the same camera angle that Tobey Maguire was saying in Spider-Man? They love me.
Okay, so we are getting to the point of an hour and a half, so we are going to have to sign off, but thank you guys very much for coming on and talking about your favorite characters, properties that are not related to Marvel.
So much cool hopefully stuff.
Yeah, a lot of cool stuff. Hope to see you again next time. And as if you might have been following, we do this every 5 episodes. For cheating, because we all have appetites, you know?
Yeah. Nope, nothing wrong with that.
I go to the sex plant sometimes.
Exactly.
Yep. Oh, yeah. I'm going to go there now, so.
I just booked my ticket with Elon Musk. I'm going to be his guest.
Oh, you know, Elon Jeff.
Lucky.
Works.
Elon Jeff.
Yeah.
What up to you if you think it's Bezos or Epstein? Just going to leave it at that.
It's kind of sad that they would all just go Fantastic Four style.
And thank you very much, Poppet Puppet, for being on it. Puppet Puppet?
Poppet.
Poppet.
P-O-P-U. So Poppet Puppet.
Poppet Puppet. Okay, I did get it right the first time. Then. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much for being a guest. And if you guys are listening, anybody at all, if you ever want to be a guest, it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't have to be. You don't have to be a writer. You don't have to be a producer. You never have to even work with Marvel. If you just want to be a guest, want to be on here, don't feel afraid to contact us. We'll just come on to the show and we'll just talk a little Marvel and see how things work out.
Yeah. We'd love to.
Make things.
Yeah, we miss you. We want you here.
Yeah,
come
where
here.
Have you been?
Yeah, don't run. Don't run.
I got the net.
Somebody ring in the dinkster.
Somebody ring in the dinkster.
Oh, Danny, I'm gonna get him. That's my boy. Anyway, so this has been the Happy 616th Marvel Family. I have been your host, the Funny Hatter, and figuratively to my right has been...
Pop it.
Oh, they move all over the place. Where are you guys going
we
everywhere?
We fucking talk. We were doing...
Yeah, we were like pacing around while you weren't looking.
Wait, why?
You've been staring at the screen the whole time. And, you know, we're playing games back here while we're talking. We're throwing a little kickball.
What yeah. games? Were you guys playing Smash again? Without me?
Well, yeah, yeah, we were. Sorry.
We only have 3 controllers. So yeah. You know how it goes.
Yeah.
I hate you guys. Forever.
It's the end of the podcast. This is the final episode.
It's like, remember, it's a happy podcast. You can't be angry. Okay, so
and that was why I was the least favorite person today, is because I was the one who initiated Smash.
Oh, no. Oh, you've learned your lesson, though, I think.
Yeah, this time I know. Maybe.
Can't make promises. But anyway, figuratively to my left has been...
Victor Rex, hello. Victor the X-Man.
Yeah, he eventually got it out. And standing right behind me today with friendly intent has been the lovely...
Always right behind you, Christopher, hello.
giving surprise back massages.
Yes, that's my that's my speciality.
Okay, thanks for listening and bye bye.
Adios.
See ya.
Victor, say bye.
just
say bye. It's not that hard.
It's just B Y E. Just a bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
I said that.
Oh, you did? You must have said it at the same time as Christopher.
Yeah, maybe.
Say it one more time.
Say it. Say it!
Bye.